This video is made possible by CuriosityStream. Get the best deal there is in streaming, both CuriosityStream and Nebula, where you can watch my brand new original feature-length documentary series, Ghost Towns, for less than $12 a year by following the link down in the description. Kazakhstan is a fairly weird country. It spans two continents with territory in both Asia and Europe, contains the most nuked location anywhere on the Earth here, where 456 nuclear bombs were detonated, and they built a brand new capital city in the 90s because they just didn't like the old one. But none of those strange facts are what this video is all about. This video is about how Kazakhstan, a large country in land, but with a small population of only 16 million people, briefly became the entire legal Soviet Union. Here's how this happened. By 1991, the Soviet Union was collapsing from the inside. It really began back in the 1980s, but some have said that it really all began in 1922, back when the USSR was first created. You see, the Soviet Union was established in the beginning theoretically as a voluntary union of various different republics that were each united under a central government in Moscow. As a federation, each of the various Soviet republics technically retained the right to secede from the USSR. But obviously, for practically all of the Soviet Union's history, this technical right was totally meaningless because the central government in Moscow wouldn't ever allow it. Some republics, like Estonia, Latvia, and Lithuania, were themselves forcibly absorbed into the Soviet Union after they were invaded in 1940. And in addition to the Soviet Union itself, there was also the Warsaw Pact, created in the aftermath of World War II, which was composed of East Germany, Poland, Czechoslovakia, Hungary, Romania, and Bulgaria, all six of which had been invaded by the Red Army, had communism forced upon them, and were effectively Soviet satellite states with negligible independence. Although also technically voluntary, membership was truly compulsory because the Soviet Army would always respond to any moves at independence from any of the governments, like they did against Hungary in 1956 and Czechoslovakia in 1968. The entire order of Soviet rule in Eastern Europe and Central Asia was kept together by force from the central government. But all of that began to change in the late 1980s. In 1985, Mikhail Gorbachev was elected as the new General Secretary of the Communist Party, and he quickly began introducing his new policies of glasnost and perestroika into Soviet society. The Soviet economy was lagging significantly behind the West, and Gorbachev initially believed that these policies would help revitalize the Soviet Union moving ahead into the 21st century. Instead, these policies largely destroyed the country. Mass censorship was reduced, freedom of speech was tremendously extended, liberal economic reforms were initiated with private individuals being able to own their own businesses for the first time. And most importantly for this story, he refused to use the Soviet military anymore to force countries and republics to remain as members of the system. The 15 Soviet republics by this point and the six other members of the Warsaw Pact were granted more authority to rule over themselves. The Chernobyl disaster the following year in 1986 didn't really help things very much either. After spewing a massive amount of radiation across Belarus and Ukraine, distrust in the Soviet central government was at an all-time high. By 1988, Gorbachev was already losing control over two geographic areas in the Soviet Union, the Caucasus and the Baltics. The Armenian and Azerbaijani republics descended into civil war and ethnic violence between themselves, while the Baltic states of Lithuania, Latvia, and Estonia were utilizing their newfound freedoms to demand independence, asserting that their absorption into the Soviet Union back in 1940 after being invaded was illegal and forced upon them. And critically, on the 16th of November, 1988, Estonia declared full sovereignty within the Soviet Union, which meant that their own laws would take precedence over Soviet laws, and they would also quit sending any tax revenues to Moscow, effectively giving themselves full 100% autonomy. Under previous Soviet rulers, this probably would have been crushed by the Red Army almost immediately, but Gorbachev was just kinda meh about it. Later in November, the Soviets ceased jamming foreign radio stations, and in 1989, things began to get extra spicy. CNN was allowed to broadcast in Moscow, and state censorship effectively became impossible. By July, Lithuania and Latvia had joined with Estonia in declaring their sovereignties. In June, the anti-Soviet Solidarity Party won an overwhelming victory in Poland, which promptly withdrew the country from the Warsaw Pact. And critically, Hungary began to dismantle their border wall fence with Austria, opening up the first hole in the Iron curtain in decades. At this point, East Germany was still ruled by a hardline Stalinist regime. Their citizens were not allowed to visit the West, but they could travel freely to other Soviet bloc countries like, say, a certain country called Hungary that just dismantled their border fence with the West. Thousands of East Germans traveled to Hungary on vacation and immediately fled into Austria and towards West Germany. Furious, the East German regime demanded that action be taken by the Soviet Union, but Gorbachev critically again refused. In August, 2 million Baltic people joined hands to create a massive human chain along the border with the rest of the Soviet Union, advocating for full independence. As the civil war and ethnic violence escalated even further in the Caucasus, Armenia followed suit and declared their own sovereignty the following month in September. East Germany was facing increasing pressure from its own citizens for democratic reforms, while their Stalinist leader, Erich Honecker, took the opposite stance of Gorbachev and refused to enact any reforms. He begged Gorbachev to use the Red Army to crush East Germany's opposition, like what they had done in Czechoslovakia and Hungary in the past. But Gorbachev continued to refuse. Instead, Honecker was forced to resign in October, and on the 9th of November, following a very confusing media broadcast, crowds of East Germans flocked to the Berlin Wall and began the process of tearing it all down. The East German communist regime collapsed, and within a year, Germany would be reunited again, and for a single year between 1990 and 1991, Germany and the Soviet Union coexisted together on world maps for the first and only time since World War II. And in December of 1989, Romania descended into a violent revolution, also withdrew from the Warsaw Pact, and executed their longtime communist dictator. The next year, in February 1990, the Soviet Union held their first ever relatively free elections in each of the 15 republics, with the Communist Party losing in 6 of them. None of the republics which had declared their sovereignties were paying any taxes to the central government, which caused the economy to get even worse. And finally, in March, Lithuania became the first of the 15 Soviet republics to officially announce their secession from the USSR. Initially, this went unrecognized by Moscow, but 2 months later, Latvia and Estonia followed suit and announced their own secessions as well. Georgia declared their sovereignty in May, and in February of 1991, the remaining members of the Warsaw Pact met in Hungary and decided that their club had no more reason to exist, and officially disbanded. Nearly a year after all three Baltic republics had seceded, Georgia became the next republic to officially secede in April of 1991. And finally in June, after leading a growing pro-democracy movement, Boris Yeltsin won the historic presidency of the Russian Soviet Republic, and promptly declared Russian sovereignty from the main Soviet government. Yeltsin was actively struggling against Gorbachev in a sovereignty battle between the Soviet government and the Russian government, and by August, Gorbachev had a plan to save the Soviet Union. He wanted to reform the country into a new decentralized federation called the Union of Soviet Sovereign Republics, thus maintaining the USSR acronym. All of the remaining republics except for Ukraine had agreed on the treaty by this point, while Kazakhstan strongly supported it. The Russian Soviet Republic was all set to sign the treaty on the 20th of August, but a group of Communist Party hardliners launched a coup the day before on the 19th in an attempt to take the country over from Gorbachev, who they believed was actively destroying the whole Soviet Union. They put Gorbachev under house arrest, attempted to arrest Boris Yeltsin, and suspended all political activity. However, Yeltsin rallied his supporters atop a tank in Moscow, and the coup support quickly evaporated. Rather than saving the Soviet Union, the coup radically destabilized the entire country and accelerated its destruction even further. Just 2 days after the coup fell apart, Ukraine seceded from the Soviet Union, amid fears that another coup would have undermined their freedoms. 3 days later, Moldova seceded. 4 days after that, Uzbekistan and Kyrgyzstan seceded on the same day. 9 days from then, it was Tajikistan that left. 12 more days and Armenia finally left, and about a month after that, Azerbaijan left as well. At the end of October, it was Turkmenistan who seceded, and by November of 1991, it was only Russia, Belarus, and Kazakhstan left. On the 10th of December, Belarus seceded, and on the 12th, it was Russia itself who seceded, which left Kazakhstan as the sole and final remaining member of the Soviet Union. It was all Russia's idea to start this whole operation, but it was Kazakhstan who was going to finish it. So for the next 4 entire days, between the 12th and 16th of December 1991, world maps would have shown Kazakhstan as being the entire Soviet Union, which, to me, is pretty amusing. But all weird things must eventually come to an end. And so, finally, after 4 days, Kazakhstan as well seceded from the Soviet Union. The USSR theoretically continued to exist as a legal entity with no territory for 10 more days until the Soviet of the Republics voted it out of existence on the 26th of December, 1991, officially dissolving the Soviet Union once and for all. And so, after just over 69 years of existence, the Soviet Union came to a final and bizarre end. Now, obviously, the collapse of the Soviet Union is an enormously complicated subject, and I've glossed a lot of the nuance over to cram this all into a 12-minute video. However, you can learn a lot more detail and context by watching this spectacular documentary called Afghanistan 1979, which chronicles the entire history of the Soviet invasion of Afghanistan and explains how it became a major contributor to the entire country's collapse. This documentary, and thousands of others like it, are, of course, available right now for you to watch on CuriosityStream, which you can get a fantastic deal on by following the link down in the description. But best of all, CuriosityStream has partnered up with my own streaming site called Nebula, where you can also watch my new original series called Ghost Towns, where I'm traveling all across the United States and later the entire world, showcasing some of humanity's most fascinating abandoned communities. Because the videos are a lot longer than my normal real-life lore content is, and the YouTube algorithm generally doesn't favor those, I'm releasing each new episode exclusively on Nebula, where you can already go and watch the first one right now about America's most famous abandoned settlement around the Salton Sea in California. You see, my creator friends and I teamed up to build our own platform where we don't have to worry about getting demonetized or buried by an algorithm that doesn't support us. It's called Nebula, and it's a place where we house all of our content you see on YouTube ad-free, and where we can experiment with brand new original content that probably wouldn't work out well on YouTube. Content like my series Ghost Towns I just mentioned. But that's just one of many exclusive pieces of content that you can get there, with even more series from channels you probably already know, like Wendover Productions, Real Engineering, Second Thought, Lindsay Ellis, Tom Scott, and many others. The best way to get access to Nebula is through the CuriosityStream bundle deal, so that when you sign up for them by following the link down in the description, you'll also get a subscription to Nebula just for free, which is free for as long as you're a CuriosityStream member. And what's even better is that right now, for a limited time, an entire year-long subscription to CuriosityStream only costs less than $12, meaning that you can get both CuriosityStream with thousands of professional documentaries and Nebula with all of your favorite thoughtful YouTubers' exclusive and ad-free content for less than $1 a month. It's the best way that you can support my channel and educational content in general, plus you get to watch some really cool and thoughtful original content. And as always, thank you for watching.